Welcome, people of God. Thank you for worshiping with us. It is good to worship the Lord together, whether we are in person or online. I also want to mention that we have a few singers in person this morning, as well as some who have recorded online. So it'll probably sound like a bigger choir than is actually here. And the other thing that they have is a singer's mask that they're all wearing, lovingly and expertly made by Stephanie Bankson. They have a little bit more room in them, so they will be singing with masks on. And this is a wonderful thing. It's actually got more room, it's a little more comfortable. So. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
God, we feel your presence, gladly we adore you, and with our heart here before you. Holy is your temple, all within keeps silence.
Let us be called to worship with a reading of Psalm 103. Listen in a spirit of gratitude. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless God's holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and do not forget all his benefits, who forgives all your iniquity, who heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from the pit, who crowns you with steadfast love and mercy, who satisfies you with good as long as you live, so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. The Lord works vindication and justice for all who are oppressed. He made known his ways to Moses, his acts to the people of Israel. The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. He will not always accuse, nor will he keep his anger forever. He does not deal with us according to our sins, nor repay us according to our iniquities. For as the heavens are high above the earth, so great is God's steadfast love for those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far he removes our transgressions from us. As a father has compassion for his children, so the Lord has compassion for those who fear him. For he knows how we were made. He remembers that we are dust. As for mortals, their days are like grass. They flourish like a flower of the field. For the wind passes over it, and it is gone, and its place knows it no more. But the steadfast love of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting on those who fear him, and his righteousness to children's children, to those who keep his covenant and remember to do his commandments. The Lord has established his throne in the heavens, and his kingdom rules over all. Bless the Lord, O you his angels, you mighty ones who do his bidding, obedient to his spoken word. Bless the Lord, all his hosts, his ministers that do his will. Bless the Lord, all his works in all places of his dominion. Bless the Lord, O my soul.
Psalm
If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. In humility and faith, let us confess our sin to God. Loving God, we confess that we have failed to live in harmony with our sisters and brothers. We have been self-righteous in our attitudes, closed-minded in our beliefs, and judgmental in our opinions. We have shunned those whose ways we do not understand, and we have despised those who do not endorse our convictions. Forgive our sins of discord and conceit, and heal our divisiveness and quarreling. Help us to be charitable in our regard for others, that we may dwell in peace with Christ, who is Lord of all. Amen. The mercy of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting. I declare to you in the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Since God has forgiven us in Christ, let us forgive one another. The peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Pray. Lord, by the power of your Holy Spirit, open our understanding that we may receive the word of life. Amen. Our lesson is not the gospel lesson, actually, but an Old Testament lesson. Genesis 50, verses 15 through 21. Realizing that their father was dead, Joseph's brothers said, "What if Joseph still bears a grudge against us and pays us back in full for all the wrong we did to him?" So they approached Joseph, saying, "Your father gave this instruction before he died. Say to Joseph, I beg you, forgive the crime of your brothers and the wrong they did in harming you. Now, therefore, please forgive the crime of the servants of the God of your father." Joseph wept when they spoke to him. Then his brothers also wept, fell down before him and said, "We are here as your slaves." But Joseph said to them, "Do not be afraid. Am I in the place of God? Even though you intended to do harm to me, God intended it for good, in order to preserve a numerous people, as he is doing today. So have no fear. I myself will provide for you and your little ones." In this way, he reassured them, speaking kindly to them. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Ever since the beginning of this coronavirus pandemic, a colleague of mine has been signing her emails with a closing phrase, "All shall be well." Most of the time for me, it has been an encouraging reminder. On occasion, though, if I received an email from her on a particularly bad day, It was kind of annoying and not very convincing. All shall be well. Right. I'm glad now that I didn't think to reply, "Well, thanks, Pollyanna." All shall be well is actually a shorter version of a rather famous quote from an ancient mystic known as Julian of Norwich. All shall be well, and all shall be well, and all manner of things shall be well. Julian lived in 14th century England as a Benedictine nun and an anchoress, a woman who set herself apart for God and lived in an isolated cell. According to a book of devotional classics, she became seriously ill at the age of 30, and in the midst of her suffering, prayed for a vision of Christ's passion. Once in a time of prayer, Julian heard the words, "I am the foundation of your praying," words that greatly influenced her spiritual life. She always pointed to the goodness of God and the love of God, a light in a time of darkness for Julian, who lived in an age of social unrest and fear of the Black Plague. Joy is perhaps the keynote in her writings, which have been called the most perfect fruit of later medieval mysticism in England. Now, did you hear that? In a time of serious illness, social unrest, and a plague, Julian of Norwich wrote about joy. All shall be well, and all shall be well, and all manner of things shall be well. Regarding Joseph and his brothers in the scripture from Genesis, they all had their moments of suffering and struggle, to be sure. And we need to know more about those struggles in order to understand today's passage better. So I'll try to make a long story short as we review. You may be familiar with the story in a more contemporary setting known as Joseph and the Amazing Technicolor Dreamcoat, a musical by Tim Rice and Andrew Lloyd Webber. I've never seen the show, but I understand it's a comedy, which the original story most certainly is not. Way back in chapter 37 of Genesis, we read that Jacob loved his son Joseph more than any other of his children, because he was the son of his old age. And that favoritism wasn't kept a secret, it was blatant, as Jacob even made Joseph a long robe with sleeves, a symbol of love. Joseph's brothers hated him because of this. And adding salt to their wound, Joseph shared with his brothers about a dream he had in which his brothers bowed down to him, and a subsequent dream in which even the sun, moon, and stars bowed down to him. Not long after this, the brothers found an opportunity for revenge. They tore the robe off Joseph and threw him into a pit, leaving him to die. But when they saw traders passing by, they instead sold Joseph as a slave. The brothers returned to their father with Joseph's robe that they had dipped in goat's blood, leading Jacob to believe that his son was dead. Now, through all of this, I don't imagine that Joseph had any thoughts of all shall be well. With his brother's betrayal, taken away from the rest of his family, alone and working as a slave in a strange country, it's more likely that he thought his life was over. As his story continues, there are some additional hardships and misfortunes that Joseph experiences. Accused of adultery by his master's wife, he is imprisoned for a time. But because the Lord was with him, and because of his ability to interpret dreams, Joseph rose to power in the land, becoming second only to Pharaoh himself. Years later, his brothers came to Egypt looking for help in a time of famine. They don't recognize him when they see him, but Joseph knows them, and he does take advantage of the opportunity to exact revenge on them, placing conditions they must meet to earn his assistance. Finally, after trips back and forth to their father and back to Egypt again, Joseph finally reveals himself to his brothers, and they fear even greater payback for the harm they did to him. They beg his forgiveness and offer to be his slaves. But Joseph replies, "Do not be afraid. Am I in the place of God? Even though you intended to do harm to me, God intended it for good." As the saying goes, hindsight is 20/20. Looking back on all the heartache, the suffering, the years of separation from his family, Joseph is in tears, still grieving all that has transpired. But I think his tears are also full of gratitude for the reconciliation that is happening and for the good that God has accomplished in him and through him. Ultimately, all that bad led to something good. I think many of us can relate to this idea. And I think it's important for us every once in a while to take time to look back over our lives and recognize all the ways that God has redeemed and even transformed our struggles to bring us into a time of rejoicing and triumph. It's that realization that helps us to say, that had to happen in order for this new reality to be born. It makes me wonder what our hindsight, months or years from now, will reveal about this terrible year of 2020. This may be the only thing that we can all agree on these days, that it has been a terrible, awful, painful, and stressful year, regardless of your age, race, social class, or location in the world. And as the months drag on and on, it becomes more and more difficult for us to proclaim with Julian of Norwich and my friend who quotes her, "All shall be well, and all shall be well, and all manner of things shall be well." Will it? And if so, when? I just heard on the news that Dr. Fauci is warning that even when we get a vaccine, the virus won't be eradicated overnight. He's cautioning that we will be well into 2021, if not into 2022, before we can begin to feel safe again. Fast forward, let's say to 2025, what will we have learned? What will be among the good things that we can say resulted from these bad times? Will we be able to look back at this year and proclaim that God transformed the evil into something good? That God brought light into the darkness? That God resurrected so much death into new life? I saw something on Facebook this week that caught my eye. "I miss 9/12," was the heading. "I would never want another 9/11, but I miss the America of 9/12. Stores ran out of flags to sell because they were being flown everywhere. People were Americans before they were upper or lower class, Jewish or Christian, Republican or Democrat. We hugged people without caring if they ate at Chick-fil-A or wore Nikes. On 9/12, what mattered more was what united us than what divided us." And there will never be a time when anyone will be grateful for the events of 9/11/01. But in hindsight, we can be grateful for the good that came out of it. Catherine died last month. She and I grew up in the same church. Her grandmother and my mother were best friends since childhood, so our families go back a long way. She was 41 years old, left a husband and 4 children. She's been battling a rare form of lung cancer for about 5 years, and she's known all along that she might not survive. So she lived very intentionally, with a singular focus on her children and family every day. She homeschooled them when she was able. She taught them to cook and take care of the house. They all went to Disney World and took another vacation with their extended family. Together, they studied about heaven to take the fear out of it for Catherine and for her children. There's nothing that will ever make it okay that she died so young. Cancer will always be evil. But in her strong faith, Catherine knew that God would always be good. And I'm certain that someday her children will look back and be grateful for all that she taught them and how she made every day count. We may not emerge from 2020 unscathed, but may we trust that God's goodness will prevail. And may we work together with the knowledge that all shall be well, and all shall be well, and all manner of things shall be well, to the glory of God. Amen.
I am hopeful, you are hopeless.
us come now, joining our hearts and our minds and our spirits in a time of prayer. Let us pray. Most gracious and loving God, we give you thanks and praise for all your goodness, which prevails over all that is evil. We give you thanks for your steadfast love, for your abundant mercy, for all the ways in which you show yourself to us. Help us to recognize your presence in our lives as Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer. We are grateful, Lord, for the beauty of creation all around us, that you have created each one of us in your image. May we remember to reflect that image wherever we go and with all whom we meet. Lord, we are grateful for the Son, your only Son, whom you sent to earth to teach us, to heal us, to show us how to love one another, and to guide us back home to you. We are grateful for his sacrifice of body and blood, that we might be forgiven. And we rejoice that you gave him new life, that we might know new and abundant and eternal life in his name. Lord, we thank you for your Holy Spirit, your presence within us and among us, connecting us in this room and across the miles to be your people. We ask your blessings, O God, for all who are in our hearts and in our minds who need your loving care. We ask your healing touch for all who are ill, for those who are suffering physically, emotionally, mentally or spiritually. We ask your comfort, Lord, for those who grieve. Strengthen the weak, bind up the brokenhearted, be a companion to the lonely, and guide all who are lost. Light your path for us, O God, and open our eyes to see it, and move our feet to follow. Fill us with your perfect peace, that we may bring peace to our troubled and broken world. We pray these things in the name of Christ our Savior, who taught us how to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. We are grateful for your tithes and offerings and ask that you place them in the wooden box, if you haven't done so already, in the narthex before you leave the building. And let us pray together the prayer of dedication. Ever-present God, just as Jesus promised to be among us when two or three gather in his name, be among us now, that our offerings may become instruments of your love and justice. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Whatever you do in word or deed, do everything in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, giving thanks to God the Father through him. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you always. Amen.